Ja, oder? Ich habe.
Alright, let's get started. So this morning we will have two talks on exciting physics and opportunities with the gravitational wave. So the first speaker is Professor Myung-Shin Im from Seoul National University. So let's welcome him.
Okay, I'm Myung-Shin Im from Seoul National University. Okay, around this time last year, I was very busy, and it was also a very exciting moment. That's because of this gravitational wave event, which happened in August 17, you know, about 1 year and maybe 10 days ago. And I'll be talking about optical follow-up observation aspect of this gravitational wave source. Okay, so it's an astronomer's point of view on this event. I will talk about the observations and the results and future prospects. Okay, so this work was done in collaboration with my colleagues in Seoul National University and also in KASI, Korea Astronomy and Space Science Institute. And also we have collaborators from NASA, Nora Troya, and also Taka Sakamoto from Japan. Okay, now that was 1 year ago, but dialing back to 3 years from now, also another probably more exciting event happened. That was the first detection of the gravitational wave source, okay, for the in the human history. That happened in 2015, September 14th, and the gravitational wave was created by a merger of two black holes that weighs about tens of solar mass, okay, that was about 1.4 billion light years away. And this event was important in two aspects. This marked the first time that humankind detected the gravitational wave, and proving that Einstein's general relativity is right. And also, more importantly in my mind, that this kind of event showed that we can now probe the universe other than the traditional way of the light, I mean, using the gravitational wave. So this was a very, very important event. Okay, but it is not without limitations, right? So this first event was detected by two LIGO detectors, but the two LIGO detectors, there was a limitation of how well you can determine the position of the source. So positional accuracy, as shown in this map here, is about 600 square degrees. Right, in terms of the area of the full moon, it's 2,500 times of full moon area. So it's really, really large area of the sky. So you can only know maybe this gravitational wave happened around that area. Right, you don't know the exact knowledge of the exact location, the environment of this event. Okay, so this was one limitation. If we knew the light, well, if we were able to detect the corresponding the optical source of this event, we can pinpoint the location. Okay, we can measure the redshift and we can accurately determine their read distance too. But that knowledge was lacking. Also, this figure kind of illustrates what happens in the black hole mergers. Right? So as you can see, that the background light is kind of gravitationally lensed, and a little bit of light is coming out, but in the black hole mergers, you don't expect to have strong optical emission, electromagnetic wave radiations coming from it, because this is black hole, and when it collides, it doesn't really leave much ejecta that creates the light. That creates the light. So the situation, even if the GW150914 was very, very exciting, we learned a lot about the universe, and also maybe from the optical observation, it was probably not possible to detect the kind of merger. But still, there was no electromagnetic wave radiation, and because of that, there was no accurate position determination, and also no accurate redshift and distance determination. And it kind of limits many astrophysical applications of this object, like probing the new phenomena like a kilonova, or using this event to probe the cosmology of the universe. So also, most importantly, like people like me, I mean, we need to observe the light, right? So if there was no electromagnetic radiation, it's not fun for us. Okay. So what we have been looking for is a gravitational wave source that accompanies the optical radiation, electromagnetic radiation. And it has been predicted that neutron star merger can do that. Okay, when the two neutron stars collide, those are two compact objects, it creates a gravitational wave. It also creates, to hold the jet direction, something called a gamma ray burst. Gamma ray burst with short duration, a duration less than 2 seconds. And there are many short gamma ray bursts already known, and they are theorized to arise from neutron star neutron merger. But there was no proof that really that, you know, the colliding mass was of order of neutron star. This was only for the jet direction, which is only a few degrees. But once the two neutron star merges, a lot of high speed neutrons emerges, and it collides with the nuclei of ions, creates heavy atoms, right? And then some of that radiates strong energies that can be a source of the phenomena called kilonova. Or some people call it different names, macronova, mini supernova, or whatever. So this kilonova event has been predicted, but has not been detected for sure. I mean, there are a few claimed, you know, detections, but there was not very secure detections. So what's the characteristic of this kilonova? So this shows a light curve, the time versus the luminosity, and also the spectrum of this event. And it can have variety of colors on the light curve shapes, depending on the production of the lanthanides or heavy ions from this R process, you know, nucleosynthesis. If there is not much heavy lanthanides, then it can have a very blue color. And if there's a lot of lanthanides, then it can have a red color because those ions tend to block the light in the blue part of the spectrum. Okay, so it could be blue or red, and people didn't know. But there were predictions. How bright they could be? Okay, so this is the light curve predictions. But in summary, if this kind of event happened at about 40 megaparsec, you would see these objects to be about 17 to 20 magnitude. That's a unit of the brightness in astronomy. But in more easy terms, it is this magnitude is bright enough for detection using 1 meter class telescopes. Right? The biggest optical telescopes nowadays are about 10 meter class, but much smaller telescopes can detect this kind of event. So how often this could happen? We still don't know for sure. Okay, this was the prediction made by 2013, and I had an opportunity to make a presentation about the electromagnetic follow-up of gravitational wave sources in Korean Astronomical Society meeting in 2014. Okay, and then there was a different phases of the autoimmune LIGO and Virgo detected operations, and this paper predicted the rate of these binary neutron star mergers. Okay, as you can see, that the range of the prediction is very large, of order of 10 to the 4, and 0.04 to 3. And so this is a large range. I wanted to have a single number. I took a natural log of these two numbers, upper limit and lower limit, and make a average of it, and these are the numbers. In 2015, you're not really expected to detect much. 2016-17, around 17, you probably average these two numbers and you expect maybe one event. This is a kind of non-scientific way of predicting the event rate. And in 2019, there will be more. Okay, so there was some hope that around this time, one binary neutron star merger might be detected by LIGO. So we prepared facilities for the optical follow-up. So we have many telescopes around the world in the Northern Hemisphere and the Southern Hemisphere. In the Southern Hemisphere, we have a small telescope, 40-centimeter telescope in Australia, robotic telescope, and also in three locations, Chile, Australia, and then in South Africa, we have a 1.6-meter wide-field telescopes called KMTNet, operated by CASI. In Korea, we have a bunch of telescopes, and we have also been using telescopes in US and also Uzbekistan. So, well, these telescopes have not been sitting either. I mean, it's been observing supernova events and gamma ray bursts. So, we were just not waiting for this event. And then 2017, August 17, an important event happened. It was about 9:50 at night in Korea. We received this notice, GCN circular notice, by email saying that there was a LIGO-Virgo identification of a possible Gaussian wave counterpart, August 17, 2017. And then the calculation of the waveform showed that it can be consistent with a neutron star binary coalescence with a host alarm rate of 1 to 10,000 years. So it's very secure detection. So this was very, very exciting. Okay. And as you can see that the other black hole mergers that were detected by LIGO and had these kind of waveforms, but neutron star merger has a much, much longer the waveform with a smaller amplitude. From this waveform, you could tell that this event was created by two compact mass of 1.4 solar mass, which is expected for the neutron star. So one prediction that you can make in this kind of event is, well, then maybe there would be a short gamma ray burst, right? So as I showed you the schematic diagram of Kiernova, right? You expect to see a gamma ray burst event. So, yeah, there was one. So, weak gamma ray burst was detected about 2 seconds later, the gravitational wave detection. And it lasted only about 2 seconds, and we can classify it from the duration point of view as a short gamma ray burst. Interesting thing was that this short gamma ray burst was not very weak, about 10,000 times weaker than a typical short gamma ray burst. So, it was something weird, actually. And the next task would be to identify the optical counterpart. Okay, gamma ray detection is great, but gamma ray telescopes, they don't have a accurate, you know, way of accurately determining the position of the gamma ray source. So it was very, very important to identify the optical counterpart. So about 11 hours after the gravitational wave detection, a telescope in Chile, and many groups actually observed this event, maybe almost simultaneously, and identified that there was this optical counterpart in a position that there was nothing, and they identified it as an optical counterpart of the gravitational wave source. Okay, we had a telescope in Australia, but by 9:50 at night, the target was already under the horizon, so we could not try to observe it. But in Chile, it was a perfect time. And this was a galaxy at this happened in a galaxy called NGC 4993 at about 40 megaparsec away in the Southern Hemisphere. So our observation, the first Korean observation happened in about 21 hours later, the gravitational wave detection using a small telescope called Isangak telescope. This was created by donation from a retired professor in our department. And it's only 43-centimeter telescope. As you can see, it's very small. But still, this event was we were able to detect this event here with small telescope. Okay, and we collaborated with people in CASI. to use this KMTNet telescope, 1.6 meter telescope at three locations in the Southern Hemisphere. And we did follow observations continuously. And around exactly almost around this time of last year, we were very busy observing this event. This is an image of the KMTNet observation, observed gravitational wave source. This is the location of the event. This August 18, from this observation was taken in South Africa, and then 4 days later, you can see that the transient has faded. But if you see very closely, maybe you can see the difference in the color a little bit. Yeah, this is a blue, but it can become like a yellowish. Actually, the color of the transient became redder as time went on. So which was kind of an important thing. This was a light curve that we created from the observations. So this is kind of blue color. So this is brighter and fainter. It evolves very fast. And red color also decays, but rather slowly. So that's why that source looked redder. And from the light curve, I mean, you can fit it, the light curve with different models of supernova, kilonova, etc. And we were able to see that the kilonova gives the best fit. Okay. Another interesting aspect of this observation, this object was that, well, the first one is the HST image. This is the Chandra image in X-ray. And actually, there was X-ray counterpart was detected, but only 9 days after the GW detection. So there was a delayed onset of X-ray. Usually the gamma ray burst accompanies X-ray almost immediately after the gamma ray detection. So almost at the same time. But this was a very peculiar event that the X-ray was detected much later. So these events were kind of summarized in this paper. So we were able to see that delayed onset of X-ray, and also we were able to constrain that this event most likely resembles the kilonova event from the optical light curve analysis. So how do we explain this? I mean, this is not ordinary short gamma ray burst. There are two major competing theories about models for this. One is called off-axis jet model, and another is called cocoon model. Those are kind of similar, but slight difference. So this is basically like a gamma ray burst event. So the gamma ray burst occurs on jet axis direction, but this jet is structured so that a little bit of gamma rays can be sneaked into toward the Earth. That's why we detected weak gamma ray burst event. And then later on, that this jet opening angle widens, and where that X-rays are created and detected by us. A cocoon model is a little bit different, and the jet is ejected too, but there are lots of surrounding media that it heats up the media, and then media is moving up toward the outer regions. Okay, so in this case, it can also explain the observed phenomena. There is other aspects of the interesting results, like host galaxy of this event, so environment of the gravitational wave source. So the host galaxy was identified as NGC 4993, as I explained before. And we did a lot of study on the host galaxy properties. What we wanted to see first is that whether this event, okay, the host galaxy of this event resembles the host galaxy of short gamma ray burst. Okay, of course, because the short gamma ray bursts are also theorized to be arising from neutron star merger. Right? So host galaxies of the short gamma ray bursts generally have they are very massive. They are old, but not too old. Maybe age should be less than a few giga years. And then there's a star formation can happen in such galaxies, but it's not vigorously happening. And there are some papers suggest that short gamma ray bursts tend to happen in outer region of the host galaxy. We did a lot of analysis. I won't go into details about the analysis. We did a fitting for the spectral energy distribution spectrum of this host galaxy and did an analysis of the shape of the galaxy too. We find this galaxy to be an elliptical galaxy, okay, with an effective radius size of this galaxy to be a few kiloparsec, and age to be larger than 2 giga years, we don't have upper limit. It can be as old as 10 giga years. Okay. But these properties are really consistent with the properties of short gamma ray burst host galaxies, so which was nice. Another important thing we can find is the distance. Okay, distance is important because there's some gravitational wave source. Wave can tell us a lot of information about the event, but the orbital inclination angle is not very well determined, and because we don't know the distance very well. And that's why the distance is important. And we use something called the fundamental plane relation, which is a relation of the size, velocity dispersion, and surface brightness of galaxy. That's tightly related. And if you measure these two quantities, velocity dispersion and surface brightness, then you can determine the size of the galaxy, and you can compare the apparent size and the size of the galaxy to derive the distance. And using this relation, we derive the distance to this galaxy to be about 38 megaparsecs, something like that. So this four event is, you can summarize it in this one slide as a multi-messenger astronomy. So gravitational wave detection, and 2 seconds later, gamma ray detection, and 11 hours later, detection in UV, optical, and near infrared. Actually, this emission probably happened around this time. We just couldn't detect it. And then later on, 9 days after, X-ray detection was done, and radar detection was done about 16 days later. Okay. So this was a really, really massive effort done with many thousands of astronomers, astrophysicists around the world. As you can see, 3 gravitational wave detectors and 70 ground-based telescope facilities, and also 7 space telescopes were used to study this event. And 45 countries, 900 institutions, and 50 groups, and about 3,700 scientists were involved in this event. And on the day of October 16, that was the time that the news was publicly announced. We need to prepare papers in 2 months and get accepted, etc. And actually, the 76 papers actually came out. This aspect of multi-messenger astronomy was summarized in this paper that appeared in Astrophysical Journal Letters. Okay, and I think that this is the most important part of this discovery. So we started multi-messenger astronomy using gravitational wave and also optical, electromagnetic wave signals. And interesting was that the number also was very, very many, about almost 3,700. And the Astrophysical Journal Letters, meaning that usually the papers are about 4 or 5 pages. Okay, this was a 59 pages paper, but with the authorist was 24 pages, acronym was 7 pages, and then tables was 17 pages. One interesting thing was it was submitted on October 3rd and accepted 4 days later. So other interesting aspect, while we have a very real proof of that neutron star-neutron star merger is happening, okay? So it gives a good theoretical ground, observational basis for short gamma ray burst is due to neutron star-neutron star merger. And there was so we found kilonova event. So this is the first convincing detection of the kilonova event, okay? Also, I didn't talk about much, but some groups tried to use this event to constrain H-naught Hubble constant. And this was first application of the constraining cosmological parameters using gravitational wave source. Okay. So if you ask, press people would ask me about the importance of this event, I explained them to, this is important because it's the start of the multi-messenger astronomy. They don't get it. They ask about, is there anything else that's more interesting? And I explain this. So neutron star, neutron star merger has been known to be, thought to be the major channel for creating heavy atoms, like gold or platinum or the uranium, something like that. So the detection of this event, secure detection of this event suggests that this was the first time that we securely found the factory of the gold. And calculations showed that from this event, about 200 Earth mass of gold was created. Okay? Then the press people were very happy. things that we don't know and we want to know in future. Okay, this was a merger of two neutron stars. Maybe what's the result? I mean, it could be a black hole or another neutron star. We don't know for sure yet. And also, there may be also the events like a black hole neutron star mergers. I mean, that kind of thing will be detected in future. Observations of this event is still ongoing. Like HST image shows that, well, this was taken in December, okay, about 4 months after the detection of the gravitational wave event. And this faint source here, you cannot see very well, but you can see from here, is the optical counterpart. It's becoming very, very faint, still visible. And the fact that it's still visible probably suggests that this may be caused by off-axis, you know, jet model. Also, distance to this event can be constrained better. The red circles mark the location of the stellar systems called globular clusters. It's a system of stars consisting of 10,000, 100,000 of stars, and their luminosity distribution it can be used as a standard candle to measure distance of this object. And from this, using the globular clusters, we were able to find the distance to be maybe 41 plus minus 3 megaparsec. So improved the accuracy of the distance measurement. Okay, I'm close to the end. Okay, so future prospects. This LIGO, advanced LIGO and Bergolons, all three run, is going to start again in 2019, February. So right now it's in upgrade stage. There will be test observations, but the official O3 run will start in February next year. So, and then there will be also operation of Japanese gravitational wave detector, Kagura. So according to this table that I showed you earlier, well, maybe we can make a prediction for the next year's operation, and maybe we can detect maybe 4 to 6 events of this kind of binary neutron star mergers. I mean, the starting one event was very, very stressing. Many papers came out. And then next year, we expect to have this kind of event almost every month. And so we are very excited and scared. Okay, thank you.
All right, so any questions?
So I often hear that this kilonova provides the source of the gold and so on, but do we see the spectral lines from these elements, or it's only that its photometric evolution is consistent?
So far, I mean, there are some papers that try to say something about the evidence for. Direct evidence for these heavy atoms from spectra, but it's heavily blended. So we generally see only the broad features, and what you can do is the modeling to fit the broad features. So some people say that you can see some of the heavy elements from that. Also, as you said, that photometric evidence is another strong proof for that these heavy ions or heavy elements are produced from this event. Yeah.
So to discriminate between from the Cocoon model from the jet opening angle jet model, can optical light contribute to discriminate it from another model?
Yeah.
Because the Cocoon, the temperature shouldn't be one right? So unique. So perhaps I think that it's a summation of the many temperature distribution around the cocoon. So is it possible to discriminate it by optical light?
In principle, it's possible, I think. Well, it may be a difficult job for now, but from the optical light, I didn't show you a slide, but the one prediction from Cocoon model is that it fits the blue light very well, but in the red light, I mean, it suggests that the light will be decaying continuously, and of XGS model have a prediction that it rises and then decays.
Yes.
So that's one way to discriminate the model.
Yeah.
So currently, I think that we need to wait for another events like that to be able to discriminate them securely. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks.
I also have one question. So among all possible optical counterparts, GRB, X-ray, kilonova, so which one is the easiest to detect?
Easiest to detect?
Yeah.
Well, that's a question. Well, in principle, like short gamma ray bursts have been detected, I mean, routinely. Right. So in some sense, it's easiest. But it but could be very, very difficult once the you are line of sight is off from the jet axis. So in that sense, majority of the short gamma ray burst event were probably hidden from us. So the fact that we haven't really detected kilonova so far means that detecting them optically has been challenging, right? So this the gravitational wave detection was a very, very maybe the easiest way to detect it in the nearby universe. I mean, if it goes to maybe beyond a few hundred megaparsec, then we may have to rely on the short gamma ray bursts or some type of deep transient search programs in future.
All right, then let's thank our first speaker.